Big news, everyone! Birds have now taken over the world. Behold your new albatross overlord, and as his first command, he is mandating that you press the subscribe button for the Grand Line Review in order to receive regular One Piece content uploaded straight into your YouTube feed, and press the bell thing to ensure that you never miss any big news. Hello and welcome to the Grand Line Review, your source for everything One Piece, and today we are here to discuss a rather provocative title, being the most powerful character in the series. And this thumbnail is probably already given away who I'm going to claim his character is, which is inevitably going to cue a bunch of comments accusing me of clickbaiting, mostly by people who don't watch the video anyway. And all I have to say to those people who aren't listening, so this is pointless, but thank you for your engagement. I appreciate it. But I wholeheartedly believe that there is no individual in this world who holds more power than Big News Morgans. And this is primarily due to the basic definition of the word power, which I will say right off the bat should not, I repeat, should not be conflated with that of strength. Because I'm sure there's also a lot of people who saw this title and went, psh, Morgans couldn't beat Kaido in a 1v1, so he cannot be the most powerful. The most powerful living character is Kaido, because he can punch harder than anyone else. Meanwhile, what power actually is either the ability to do something in a particular way, or the capacity to influence the behavior of others, or a course of events. And all of a sudden, it's starting to look like Big News Morgans is slotting very, very nicely into the definition of power. And as I'm going to go on to show, he probably does so much more so than any other figure in One Piece. Now, in case anybody watching this video is, for whatever reason, unaware, Big News Morgans is the president of the World Economic Times, the key source of delivering news and current events throughout the globe. Because despite the fact that visual transponder snails do indeed exist, and have actually been used to broadcast globally, such as with the Paramount War, the One Piece world still very much operates via newspaper and literal carrier pigeon. But the words printed in said newspaper are a huge source of power that Morgans and Morgans alone wields. We'll get into that in a bit more detail though, because to round out our introduction to Mr. Birdman, I should also say that he isn't actually a bird. He's assumedly a human who has eaten a Zoan-type devil fruit, being the Toritorinomi model albatross, which was revealed in his Vivio card entry, and it would appear that he just prefers to stay in either full beast or human beast hybrid form as a personal life choice. Which, yeah, sure. But as a birdman, he is a fixed point of high society, not quite as high as the world nobles. However, I would have no qualms in calling Morgans by far the most connected individual in the series, a very prominent example of which can be seen in his introduction, as he was an honored guest at Big Mom's tea party. So he has a close relationship with at least one Emperor of the Sea, but in addition to that, he is also connected to seemingly every major facet of underworld trade, and in fact, Morgans is even known as one of the emperors of the underworld. So this gives him access to levers of power that not even the world government would have comfortable access to. Although one of the other emperors of the underworld is a CP0 agent, so maybe that's not so true. Speaking of though, Morgans has quite a profound relationship with said world government, which was displayed through Stussy, the aforementioned CP0 agent. They have a give and take dynamic, with Morgans being able to obtain exclusive scoops in exchange for omitting certain details from events, or in some cases, just plain printing propaganda for the world government. And I take the time, a lot of time, to point this out because there is a common misconception I see a fair bit that Morgans works with or even for the world government as their media branch, but that is blatantly untrue. Big News Morgans and the World Economic Times is, rather amazingly, an individual entity of its own, which only makes it that much more terrifying and powerful. Because let's think about that for a second. This Birdman has a near monopoly on global news that no Emperor of the Sea or even the world government can even come close to competing with, much less conquering. In fact, I'll let this quote from Morgans pretty much sum up his feelings on the matter. "Don't mess with Big News Morgans if you know what's good for you. I may be a money-hungry Scrooge, but first and foremost, I am a journalist. As a DJ of the printed page, I get hearts dancing, and I'm the one who decides what news is fit to print." So yeah, he is the most connected figure in the series, essentially able to access anyone or anything he so desires, and Morgans is also able to speak to almost literally everybody in the world. Whatever Morgans decides to print in his newspaper becomes an undisputed global fact, even if it was completely fabricated. He can create whatever he wants, he can sway public opinion in any direction, and if he really so desired it, he could influence and incite major world events. Now that is what I would call power. And if you still don't believe me yet, then that's fine, because we still have not gotten to the truly meaty bits here, because I think you'll be gobsmacked at just how integral the very concept of media has been in shaping this world that we know and love. But first of all, I do want to point out that obviously, Morgan's power is not unlimited. He can't just take something from nothing. For example, he could not just publish a front page article stating that Tonjit had become the Pirate King because, well, it's too absurd. There always needs to be an element of truth in what he's doing, which is shown to us quite brilliantly in the example of Luffy being published as the Fifth Emperor. Morgans could not just claim this about any old schmuck. He needed to capitalize on the infamy that Luffy had built over his pirate career, much of which would have been reported on by the World Economic Times, actually. But after Luffy had reached that critical mass of chaotic events under his belt, Morgans had the license to effectively crown Luffy as an Emperor of the Sea. And whether our rubber lad deserves it or not, or actually whether he even wants it or not, which he most certainly doesn't, that is indeed what happened. And there was nobody in the world that could stop this. There were people like Blackbeard who say it's too early for Luffy to be an emperor, or those like Kaido and Big Mom who deny Luffy entirely, or even the world government who would rather, you know, not create another gigantic infamous pirate faction, but all of them are completely powerless to stop Morgans. And I've talked about the Luffy emperor thing a lot on this channel, and so to get away from that, I actually have an even better example to display the very power within Morgans' grasp. Because what if I told you that he was responsible for creating the Pirate King? Very bold claim there, I know, but something that recently twigged for me in regards to Roger's journey is how exactly he became the Pirate King. So much so that I am planning a whole video on that subject matter, but early spoiler alert for part of it, it wasn't by circumnavigating the globe or landing on Luffy's tail. Roger became the Pirate King because that's what was printed in the news. Roger didn't come up with that title himself, nor did his contemporaries. In fact, there's a fairly amusing section that we have of him in the series reading an article about himself. And in the newspaper article, it said, "The man who achieved wealth, fame and power, the king of the pirates, Gold Roger." To which Roger replies, "Hey, that's Gold D Roger, but I gotta say, king of the pirates, that has a nice ring to it." And that, ladies and gentlemen, was the birth of the entire concept of a pirate king. Now, I will say that obviously I cannot confirm that Morgans himself came up with the name, although he certainly is old enough to have been president of the World Economic Times during this era. But I do have to admit that it could have been the work of Morgans' predecessor. That is beside the point though. The fact is that one decision made by a media conglomerate turned Roger into the most infamous figure in, I suspect, the history of the world. Or at least the world so far. I'm sure that Luffy is going to shatter that. But furthermore, through this, the World Economic Times also indirectly began the Great Age of Piracy. Because if Roger had not been labeled as the Pirate King by the organization, then he would not have had command over the world's attention during his execution. And this is just the greatest example of that quote from Morgans I gave you before in action, because it lit a fire of desire throughout the globe, and unprecedented masses of people set out to start a life of piracy in the hopes of becoming the next Pirate King. A title that had been completely made up. And whether it was Morgans who did this back then or not, the fact remains that he is currently the caretaker of that power. When the time is right, it is once again going to fall to him to, as officially as possible, crown the next Pirate King, which I think we can fairly say will be Luffy. Spoiler alert for the end of One Piece, I guess. And by then, yes, Luffy will have earned it, just as Roger had, but the world is not going to recognize him until that is widely reported, because that is how media works. There's a kind of general misconception that news is a reactive entity, you know, an event happens and an outlet reports that fact that happened. But it's actually the other way around. The news tells you what to think. And that gives Morgans insane power because he has a global monopoly on people's hearts and minds. They believe what this newspaper says, en masse and generally unquestionably. And look, if that's what happened with the Pirate King, then you'd best believe that's also how things went down for some of our other important titles, like Emperors, for example. Where did those titles come from? Well, given who these erratic figures are, I highly doubt that they gathered together and came to a consensus of what to call themselves. No, it's more than likely the exact same thing that happened with Roger. They all woke up, read the newspaper one day, and found out that they were each considered one of the four emperors of the sea. And yes, there is also an example for things like names, which can be spread more organically, word of mouth style. For example, a random pirate having drinks with other pirates, and he casually recognizes these figures and calls them the four emperors, which everyone in the immediate vicinity likes the sound of, and then it spreads through common vernacular. And maybe that does become so common that the president of the World Economic Times decides to publish that name, but that is the most important act. Stating that title in the world's primary source of news is what makes it quote unquote official. It's what makes people pay that much extra attention to Whitebeard, Kaido, Big Mom, and Shanks. In fact, actually, there's no guarantee that Shanks even was one of the original emperors. He was apparently crowned 4 years before Luffy set out from Goa Kingdom, so he could have been quite the newcomer, really. But who do you think gave Shanks the emperor title? Would it have been his fellow emperors? Probably not, considering Whitebeard completely disregarded him during the Return to Water 7 arc, and given how volatile volatile Big Mom and Kaido are, I just don't see them rolling out the red carpet for a person who was a literal child when they were all making waves in the world as members of the Rocks Pirates. And it's the same with Blackbeard, actually. Sure, he acquired some territory and defeated the remnants of the Whitebeard Pirates with his own forces, but once again, we're not going to cut to Big Mom and Whole Cake Island going, yep, he's an emperor now. No, she would deny that to her last living breath. The only person in this world who has the power to conclusively label someone as an emperor, or anything else quite frankly, is currently Big News Morgans. I am 100% certain that's what he did with Blackbeard, and it's entirely possible that that's what happened with Shanks as well, and the original emperors, along with Roger and the Pirate King title. And while Morgans, once again, cannot do this with just anybody, he is still the king maker of One Piece. His words hold unparalleled power to completely reshape the knowledge and accepted standards of every living being in this series. Under the right conditions, Big News Morgans can make anything possible. If he so desired it, he could probably even commence a global revolution against the world government by aligning himself with the revolutionaries and publishing some of their knowledge. Luckily for the world government, I suppose that's not what Morgans is all about. But he is still a terrifying journalist who wants nothing more than to make people's hearts dance to his beat. Whether that dance is one of happiness, sadness, or even terror, I'm not so sure that matters. What is important is that he is the DJ of this entire planet. Morgans has complete and sole discretion over dictating the mood and atmosphere of the world, which is far more powerful than a mere emperor, the hidden King Eam, or even the former or future Pirate King. But what do you guys think? Please do leave your thoughts in the comments below or even join my Discord server. And if you'd like to see more videos like this, then please do go and check out some of my other content or even subscribe to the channel for more glorious One Piece business uploaded straight into your YouTube feeds. But for now, this has been the Grand Line Review, and I'll see you next time.